Welcome to the Power of Food podcast. We are so excited to bring you evidence-based nutrition information focusing on addressing the root cause for imbalance. Food has the power to help you achieve lifelong optimal health without the side effects of prescription medication. Subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or any other podcast platform. I am Stacy Seslowski, functional nutrition registered dietitian.
And I am Leah Grace Barrick, functional nutritionist. Hello, everybody. Welcome to episode number 14 of the Power of Food podcast. We are super excited to be here on this Valentine's Day to talk about heart healthy eating and living. Thought that was an appropriate topic to address today for the occasion. So how are you doing, Leah?
I'm good, Stacy. Thank you. Thanks for that introduction. Happy Valentine's Day, everyone. You know, whether you celebrate or not, it's just a great excuse to focus on heart health because cardiovascular disease is the number one killer in the world. And there are so many things that we can do through diet and through lifestyle that we're going to be talking about today that can help prevent or help these conditions. So before we get rolling, we just wanted to give a shout out to Stacy and my favorite bagel company. They have paleo bagels. So these are grain-free bagels made with super clean ingredients, and they're called Pagels. And they've been kind enough to offer our listeners a 10% off discount off your order with the promo code POF10. So like Power of Food 10. And so we hope you guys try it. We love these bagels again. So if you're gluten-free or, you know, trying to avoid grains, going a little bit lower carb, you should definitely give these a try.
Awesome. I honestly, every single weekend, my husband comes up with another way of making those bagels, adding another topping, you know, another. And every time he does it, I'm like, you've got to take a picture of that. That company would love it.
Yes, definitely. So good.
Yeah. So we can jump right in and talk about, I thought like one interesting way to begin this conversation about heart health is to talk about what a lot of people believe as the cause for heart disease and heart attacks in particular. And many people believe, or we learned, you know, many years ago that it was caused by sort of this like clogging of the arteries, right? Where, you know, like maybe it was fat buildup or accumulation of something that was blocking blood from moving through the artery. And we're learning actually that that's not the real accurate description of the cause of this condition. And instead of clogging of the arteries, what's actually happening is that there's a bit of an injury that takes place within the artery, and then your body will send out immune cells to this spot of the injury the way that your body would react to almost any injury, you know, even one that you get on your skin, and it sends out immune cells, and that's why you get redness and swelling and things like that. And that is actually what's happening in the interior of the arteries that lead to our heart. And there's a bit of an injury. The body sends out immune cells to that spot, and that sort of type of inflammation and immune reaction is what is leading to that heart condition, heart disease, and then finally heart attack. So if we think about it in this more accurate way, then we can use food to understand that if we are lowering inflammation and eating foods that prevent your immune cells from reacting to these types of injuries, as you know, as to the extent that they are, then we can hopefully prevent those types of conditions and heart attacks and heart disease in general. So the first way that I think we could use food to prevent these conditions is by choosing whole, unprocessed foods. By choosing these types of foods, we are providing, we are inhibiting inflammation, and then we're also providing the foods that can actually lead to anti-inflammation. So let's, if we think about when you walk around the perimeter of the supermarket and you see all the foods and that are fruits and vegetables, animal protein, and they look there in the store the way that they look when they were picked out of nature, that means nothing was taken out of the food and nothing was added to the food between the time they were taken from nature and brought into your supermarket. And that means that those are whole, unprocessed foods. They won't cause inflammation in your body because your body will recognize them as a food. So it doesn't look like a foreign invader or a toxin by any means. And so your body will not have an inflammatory reaction. And instead, it will be, those foods will be full of vitamins and minerals and healthy proteins and healthy fats that your body can use to prevent further inflammation. So just as a number one priority, if we're looking at heart health, that would be my first recommendation, is to include whole unprocessed foods as the main portion of your diet.
Awesome. Thank you so much for that, Stacey. That was beautifully said, especially the description about how we used to think it was clogging of the arteries, and it's much more nuanced than that, and it has a lot to do with the immune system and the inflammatory response. I remember when we first learned that in our grad program, and I was like, wow, that is really crazy because it's not talked about that much in conventional medicine. So really glad you went there and explained that for our listeners. And whole unprocessed food, as Stacey said, is super important. And within that, we can talk about fiber. So I talk about fiber a lot. We talk about fiber a lot, but fiber is really important for heart health because what fiber actually does is it helps carry excess cholesterol out of the body. So soluble fiber can actually decrease total and LDL cholesterol concentration. So LDL is kind of like the bad cholesterol is what people often say, just to really simplify it. So eating fiber can help lower your cholesterol in your body. And it can also help decrease inflammation. So what Stacey just said about inflammation being a root cause of cardiovascular disease, eating fiber can actually lower our inflammation. It can also help improve our insulin resistance, which I won't go into right now because Stacey's going to cover in a little bit, but fiber is really important for that as well. And a lot of studies show that fiber is actually beneficial for preventing heart disease. And so it's thought that this happens both because it helps lower cholesterol and it also can help lower blood pressure as well. So if you're dealing with high cholesterol, high blood pressure, one of the first things I always tell my clients is increase your fiber a lot. And so usually I tell people, you know, aim for about 30 grams a day. If you can, the more the better typically. And fiber, you know, fills you up. So it can also help prevent overeating, excess eating, weight gain, which we know can be inflammatory. And there are different kinds of fiber. So we want to include soluble fiber and insoluble fiber. Some examples of insoluble fiber are whole grains, legumes, vegetables like carrots and celery, and also some fruits like tomatoes. And then soluble fiber are a lot of fruits, and then also oatmeal, beans, nuts, seeds, and then fruits like apples, berries, citrus fruits, and pears. So all of those. So fiber is essentially always in plant foods. So our fruits, our vegetables, our legumes, our nuts, and our seeds. So the more fiber, the better. Fiber is great for heart health. Really try to up your fiber. Most people don't even get half the amount of fiber that they should be getting every day. And of course, going whole foods route for that is the best, but there also are ways you can supplement.
Yes. So many things that we're going to be talking about today that I feel like maybe we should have called it like the myth, you know, like there's so many myths that we thought were one way and now they're going to be another. And what I'm about to mention next will fall into that category as well. But I love that conversation about fiber. And I was just going to mention that, you know, we recommend somewhere like a little, like 30 grams of fiber per day, maybe more. And so if you want to know how much you're eating, you could like maybe fill out one of those apps on the phone where it calculates your calories and your intake all day. It's worth, you know, filling in what you're eating in a day or two and just seeing if you're reaching that 30 or more grams of fiber per day. I think that's a helpful tool to calculate that. Going back to my myth buster, the next comment that I was going to make is about eating fat. And we were told for so long that fat is the, you know, especially saturated fat is the absolute cause of heart disease and heart failure. And just like I said before, you know, clogging of the arteries was that myth that, you know, sort of brought this about. And it was supposedly that the arteries were getting clogged with fat itself. And that's why this whole like sort of theory went through that was like, if you eat a lot of fat, your arteries are going to get clogged, and that's how it's going to lead to these conditions. So now not only do we know that, you know, clogging of the artery is not the cause of heart disease, but we also know that it's not actually that, you know, eating fat is what causes these conditions. In fact, one of the most healthy diets in the world that's been, you know, most highly researched is the Mediterranean diet. And one of the really main parts of the Mediterranean diet is the consumption of olive oil and other healthy fats like nuts and seeds and the healthy fish, you know, fatty fish like salmon and tuna and mackerel. Those are all the biggest portion of the Mediterranean diet. And so we're learning that eating, you know, healthy fat is especially important for heart health. So healthy fats could include those monounsaturated fats, like I've mentioned, the olive oil and the nuts and the seeds. And then also the polyunsaturated fats, which is the kind of fat that you get when you eat the fatty fish, like salmon and tuna and things like that. So mono and polyunsaturated fats are especially healthy for heart health. They actually are considered anti-inflammatory. So like I said before, we're always trying to reduce inflammation striving for inhibiting heart disease. And so using foods that can, that could promote anti-inflammation are best. So like I said, the monounsaturated, the polyunsaturated, and we're even learning that including saturated fat, yes, saturated fat is not the worst thing for you. In small amounts, like everything in moderation, obviously, but eating saturated fat is not actually the cause of heart disease. As I explained before, we are not clogging our arteries with fat. That is not what is happening. What's happening is there is an injury in the artery that's causing inflammation, an immune response, and that's what's leading to the heart disease. So in general, this should not be a food that we are avoiding by any means, and making sure that we're especially emphasizing the omega-3s and the monounsaturated. And if we are going to eliminate fat, I would only recommend trying to reduce some of the omega-6 fatty acids. And that's the fat that is found in seed oils and some other highly processed foods. That is the one type of fat that I would say we should cut back on. But other than that, let's include these healthy fats in our diet. It's especially important for heart health.
Absolutely. Totally agree with everything you just said. Really well articulated, especially because fat is a very nuanced topic. And most people want to hear fat is good or fat is bad. And it doesn't work that way. And I'm glad you brought up the omega-6 as well, because most people eat way too much omega-6 inflammatory fats and not nearly enough omega-3 fats. And it's thought that, you know, the ratio, which is what really matters, should be somewhere between 1 to 2 to 1 to 4 of omega 3 to omega 6 fats. And most people are eating like 1 to 20 omega 3 to omega 6. So it's really, really crazy how much more omega 6 fats are in most people's diets and contributing to this epidemic of inflammation, honestly. Because, you know, we talk about this a lot, but these refined oils that are really high in omega 6 are everywhere. They're cheap, they're neutral. Restaurants use them, people use them because they don't know. So really trying to make a conscious effort to increase the omega-3s and decrease the omega-6s will make a big difference.
Exactly.
So moving on, I wanted to talk a little bit about nitrates and potassium regarding heart health, because these two are often not at the forefront of what we hear about when we're talking about heart health and cardiovascular disease in conventional medicine. And both of these highlight the importance of optimizing our blood flow in our bodies. So nitrates are basically natural chemicals that help dilate, so they widen or relax our arteries and our veins, both in the heart and elsewhere in our body. So by dilating these blood vessels, then nitrates can help reduce the stress on the heart by improving our blood flow to the heart. So when I'm talking about nitrates, I'm not talking about, you know, the sodium nitrates that are found in processed meats. That's something totally different. We don't want those. But there are foods that have natural nitrates in them that can help increase these nitric oxide levels in our body and help dilate our blood vessels. Some of my favorite foods for this are beets, garlic, green leafy vegetables. So especially arugula, but also kale and spinach are great. Pomegranates are awesome for this, nuts and seeds, watermelon, and then also most people's two favorites are red wine and cacao, so chocolate. So this is partly why dark chocolate can be really helpful for increasing blood flow in the body and helping with cardiovascular disease. So those are all nitrates. And then we can also talk a bit about potassium. So again, this isn't often brought up because the focus for heart health and blood pressure is usually on sodium. So yes, salt is a big issue in processed foods, but if you're eating a whole foods diet, like Stacey mentioned in the beginning, from real foods, then decreasing your sodium is actually unlikely to decrease your blood pressure. So salt and potassium are interrelated and we need salt. So we would die without salt, essentially. We need to eat it and it's not inherently bad. So I would argue that the problem is most people are actually not getting enough potassium versus, you know, getting too much sodium. And so the more potassium you eat, the more sodium you actually lose through urine. So potassium, again, helps relax those blood vessel walls, and that can help lower blood pressure. Potassium also can help regulate our heartbeat. So all of that is what makes it great for heart health. And potassium foods or potassium-rich foods are things like fruits and vegetables. In particular, some of my favorites are bananas, sweet potatoes, and avocados. So that's just kind of a general overview of why you should include nitrate-rich foods and potassium-rich foods in your diet.
I love that. I swear, I feel like this entire episode, I could be like, myth bust right there. Like, it's true. I mean, people are so stuck on the idea that, you know, with heart conditions, you have to lower your salt. It's the first thing. Even doctors are giving that advice. Yeah. You know, it's not just like it's well-educated, highly, you know, intelligent and professional, you know, medical doctors are giving that advice. And I think you're 100% spot on that that's not actually the problem, and that it's more of a problem of not getting enough of the potassium, not getting enough of the whole unprocessed foods, rather than it being a problem of too much sodium. So good, really good description right there. Okay, my next one is also really interesting, I think, because I feel that people separate the condition of diabetes and blood sugar dysregulation and that condition from heart disease, and they're looked at as two separate conditions that are not anywhere, you know, connected, and it's actually not the case. And in functional medicine, integrative medicine, you know, holistic, we really do look at everything as connected. And there is no question that insulin resistance, which is normally in the same bucket as diabetes, is connected to heart disease. And I'll explain why. As your body begins to have trouble regulating blood sugar, your body will send out more and more insulin, because insulin has the role of taking the blood sugar out of the blood and putting it into your cells. So as your blood sugar goes up, your body says, okay, we need more insulin to take that blood sugar down. But what else does insulin do? Insulin is also the hormone that tells your cells to store fat. So all of a sudden, you start to gain some adipose tissue, some fat tissue. And what does fat tissue do? Fat tissue releases inflammatory cells. So right there, insulin resistance means your body will send out more insulin. That more insulin will tell your body to store more cells that contain fat, and then that fat will cause inflammation. So we're seeing the connection here between blood sugar dysregulation, higher levels of insulin, and then fat cells and inflammation. And we already talked about the fact that inflammation can cause heart disease. So right there is a good connection. So it's the problem itself may initially start off with high blood sugar, which can be better controlled when we cut back on our sugar intake, when we cut back on our simple carbohydrate intake, and rather focus on complex carbohydrates, eating meals that contain protein and fat, not just carbohydrate by itself. We can learn to better control our blood sugar that way, but really the problem ends up happening because we end up secreting just too much insulin. Insulin is the problem here, not necessarily, you know, the blood sugar itself, or, you know, that the insulin is actually what's leading to those next, you know, side effects that are causing the heart disease. So I think that the more we follow all the recommendations we've already made, eating whole unprocessed foods, increasing our fiber intake, choosing those healthy fats to include in our diet, the more we will better control our blood sugar and prevent our bodies from the need to send out more insulin. I wanted to mention one more way, though, to control that, but just take really quick, is this whole thought process of intermittent fasting. Now, I usually don't recommend going to the extent that sometimes some people do with intermittent fasting, where they're fasting for 24 hours or more, sometimes several days in a row. But I would recommend trying at least to avoid snacking and trying to give yourself a good 4 to 5 hours in between each meal, and then a good 10 to 12 hours over the night. That alone will also help your body regulate blood sugar, prevent the need for additional insulin, and that whole cascade of events that I've already described. So,
awesome. Very well said. Yeah, insulin is a huge one. So I'm really glad we're including that here, because like you said, it's often forgotten, not talked about, spoken as something totally separate from cardiovascular disease.
Yeah.
And we know it's not. So that's great. So there are tons of lifestyle tips that we can do in addition to our diet to help prevent cardiovascular disease. So we're just going to cover a few of them that I find pretty important and that I recommend to most of my clients. And the first is exercise. So again, this helps increase blood flow. Like we talked about, blood flow is so important. And our hearts are organs, but they're organs made of muscle. So just like we need to work out our muscle, like you work out your bicep to make it stronger, you need to work out your heart to make it stronger. So this is what cardiovascular exercise is doing. And so doing regular cardio is really important. We just want to make sure we don't overdo it, because overdoing it can actually contribute to stress, which can contribute to inflammation and then kind of do the opposite of what we want. So cardiovascular exercise is great. Stress is a big one. So stress increases our blood pressure and our heart rate. So decreasing stress, which I know is so much easier said than done, that is a huge one. So whatever, you know, lifestyle things that you do for your body that help you release stress, do those things as much as you can. And if it's meditation or deep breathing, any of that is great. Take a bath. Sometimes I feel like I say reduce stress so often, it kind of loses its importance, but it's that important. It's really, really important to address and not just, you know, figure out later or put to the wayside. Sleep is another one that's really important. So when we sleep, it actually allows our heart to rest and recover. And during sleep is when our blood vessels and our arteries actually heal and recover. So again, this is especially important for preventing that cascade that Stacey was talking about with the injury in our epithelium. So when we sleep, it allows that to heal. This one's pretty straightforward, but if you smoke, quit smoking. Just do it. It's really, really important. I know it can be really hard for people and a huge struggle, but you know, if you're worried about cardiovascular disease, that is a great reason to stop now. And then also, you know, caffeine, don't overdo it. It can raise blood pressure, contribute to stress, fine in moderation, but I see some people drinking like 8 cups of coffee a day, which it's just too much for the body to handle. And then, of course, back to smoking. Smoking can actually cause damage in blood vessels and arteries and contribute, again, to that cascade that Stacey was talking about. And lastly, I wanted to talk about saunas. So regular sauna usage can improve cardiovascular function. And there's been tons of studies on this. It's really fascinating. But essentially, it can improve endothelial function and dilation. So endothelium is what's lining our arteries and our veins. And so it can help decrease arterial stiffness. It can also help modulate our autonomic nervous system. So this is our sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. Doing the sauna can also help improve your circulating lipid profiles, and it can help lower blood pressure. So some studies have shown that sauna usage might actually be as good as exercise for the heart. So essentially, it increases your heart rate in the short term, and it also has a natural diuretic effect. So that's how it can help you lower your blood pressure, decreasing the amount of work that your heart has to do. And it also just helps people relax. So again, going back to the stress, going in the sauna can help you relax, which can lower stress, which we know is important. Other studies have shown that people who frequently use saunas have lower rates of heart disease and Alzheimer's than those who use saunas less. So if you have access to a sauna, do it as much as you can. It can be really beneficial. I know it's hard right now with COVID and gyms are closed and most people use the sauna at their gym, but you know, just keep that in mind for when things start to open again, that it can be really helpful.
Do you, or have you ever looked into like a sauna in your house?
We actually just got one.
You're kidding. No, which one did you get? Because I look into it all the time and I just always find myself like, what? Well, I'll wait. I don't know which one to get.
It's so funny because like I've heard that with the pandemic and with everyone living at home, they've been selling at like an all-time high. So we got a traditional Finnish one. It's the Almost Heaven barrel sauna. It's a two-person. I probably would have gotten the infrared if it was just up for me, just because of the health benefits are a little bit different. And I'm not someone who likes the heat quite as much. So essentially, the traditional is much higher temp and the infrared is lower temp, but it goes a little bit deeper, detoxes a little bit deeper in your body.
Right.
But also the infrared, you know, have EMFs. So it's
nice. I know, and that's what worries me.
Yeah. Some of them have EMF blocking, But with the traditional, like, you don't have to worry about it at all because there's no EMF. So
interesting. Okay.
My mom actually recently got an infrared, which is amazing. I can send you the info on that if you're interested. And it's the highest blocking of EMFs on the market. So that one might interest you if that's what you're worried about.
Cool. Yeah, no, absolutely. I've looked into so many of them and it's always like the combination of either the EMF or it doesn't fit right into like the situation in my house. And there's always something that's like, that I'm like, all right, I'll just wait.
Right. I know. It's been so nice because we actually just got like the first snowstorm in Portland and I don't know how long, and the city's shut down. Like, nothing's open. None of the streets are plowed because they don't have any plows. So it's been really nice because we've just been going in the sauna when it's freezing out. So it's been really good.
No, I do want to get one. I know how healthy it is for, you know, your skin, just detoxing. Totally want it. So this, my last one, I think is a really fun, cool one, especially for Valentine's Day. But if you think about the feeling that you get when you give somebody a hug, or when you, you know, you have like touch, human touch, and it feels calming and it feels like, you know, like a lift of stress and things like that. And that there actually is a chemical reaction inside that is causing those feelings, you know? It's like there's always a scientific reason for everything. But there's a hormone that our body releases during those types of human touch and hugs that is called oxytocin. So if you ever want to, you know, do some fun research on a hormone, search oxytocin and you'll see that that's a really great one. It's what happens when we are experiencing human touch, when we give people a hug or rub their back or things like that. And what is actually happening is that promotes, I guess, your parasympathetic tone. So parasympathetic is that system in our bodies that causes rest and digest. It causes people to calm down, to fall asleep at night. And what research has shown is that oxytocin promotes the parasympathetic tone. It increases the nitric oxide release. And just as Leah described before, nitric oxide is what is responsible for vasodilation of our arteries. So again, as we widen the arteries and we allow blood to move more smoothly through the arteries, then we're obviously preventing heart conditions, heart failure, and heart disease. There's also research to show that it releases that nitric oxide, it reduces blood pressure, and that it reduces inflammation. So one of the markers, and this gets really scientific, but one of the markers for inflammation is a blood marker called C-reactive protein. And we've learned that oxytocin can reduce that blood marker, which is a good sign that it is anti-inflammatory, and that it also can reduce fatty liver, fat cells, and I've already talked about the fact that fat cells release inflammatory cells. So all of these things combined does explain that human touch and interaction and hugs can absolutely improve your heart health and prevent cardiac injury. So I thought that's
so cool. Thanks for sharing. That's so interesting. Oxytocin is one of those hormones that is so fascinating to learn about. Mm-hmm. I remember learning, I can't remember where it was, but so like you said, on the back, we have a ton of oxytocin receptors, which is why when you get a big like bear hug, it feels so good. Also though, dogs have oxytocin receptors on their stomachs, which is why if you think about like rubbing a dog's belly, they go crazy.
Yep.
That's kind of what happens. And so it's really interesting to think about. And that's really cool that it can lower inflammation, has all those other effects. So very cool.
Yeah, I love it. Well, this was fun. I think that these were some really good tips. I mean, if we can just like eat more whole unprocessed foods, eat more fiber, eat more healthy fats, and, you know, improve our blood sugar, do the exercise, stress coping mechanisms, and sweating and hugging. I think we'll all have a really healthy, you know, future, and especially a healthy and happy Valentine's Day if you're celebrating.
All right. Well, thank you everyone so much for joining us. If you want to reach out to us, we love questions, comments, anything. You can find me at gracefunctionalnutrition.com and my email is gracefunctionalnutrition@gmail.com. I'm also on Instagram at gracefunctionalnutrition.
And I am Stacy Sizlewski with Heal From Food. And my email address is stacy@healfromfood.com. And also I am available at social media, Heal From Food, Facebook, Instagram, and all those fun places.
Awesome.
Well, it was awesome to see you.
You too, Stacy.
We'll have a happy Valentine's Day, everybody. And we'll see you next time.